Thought our guys did a great job in the last three games. Most importantly, protecting our home court. Playing better on both ends of the floor. Trying to get the numbers, both offensive and defensive, where we think they could and should be. But just a good all-around effort. But I think that's what happens offensively when you make shots, have good spacing, do a better job in cutting. Because shooting the ball well brings a lot of confidence, enthusiasm, and somehow guys manage to play a little bit better on the defensive side of the ball, so that's always good. But we've had probably two good weeks of practice and guys getting better. And the thing that's always good for me as a coach, a good sign when you have guys that don't play a lot and they get opportunities to play, they go in and play like they've played before, continue to compete, play hard, have enthusiasm. And another thing we talk about, be ready when your numbers call. And I think DeMontre Edwards, Derek Reese have been two great examples of that, being ready to play when your numbers call. And, the other thing we've done a good job all season long is taking care of the basketball. I think one of five teams in the country, if I'm not mistaken, of maybe 9.2 turnovers a game, which is not an easy thing to do with two new point guards, though talented, new pieces out there. And, I give a lot of credit to Jerron Maimon. One of the areas that he struggled with 2 years ago was taking care of the basketball, even though he did a lot for us with the basketball, facilitating, driving the ball. He probably had just as much as our point guards, but he's done a great job of really getting his turnovers down. So just a great team effort.
Any update on Hubs?
Hubs fine. He practiced yesterday. And there was not a lot of contact, but he was fine. And the little contact we did do, he was fine.
Was he ready to play?
Yes, yeah, yeah. If he's fine today, unless something happens today. But he was fine yesterday. There was no signs of me saying he wouldn't play Tuesday.
We've kind of gotten used to Jordy Mack and his game and his scoring ability, and maybe taking for granted a little bit, the league recognizing him today. Just talk a little bit about what he's done.
Well, I mean, Jordan's a guy that scores the ball. He does a good job of scoring. And again, I get on him all the time. So I thought even in the last game against Tusculum, I thought he passed up opportunities to score the ball. But because he's trying to be a willing passer, get guys open. I understand that part, but there are opportunities he has to attack the rim. I think he attacks sometimes looking to pass as opposed to scoring the ball. So I just tell him to be conscious that you're in attack mode all the time and let the other guys, space up. Big guys, be ready to catch and shoot when you pass the ball. But other than that, you're looking to score it. Because I thought maybe in watching film, he passed up five shots in the last game. Because I'm a guy wanting to score, but take good shots, be aggressive, squaring his shoulders up. And I thought he got off to a good start, last year, really scoring the ball. He had 34 against LSU, but his transition started to come when he was catching and shooting and pulling up as opposed to a lot of leaners and floaters. And I thought he did a good job making that adjustment.
Are you playing as well defensively as you'd like?
We were a C. I think we're probably B now. I think we were a C, but I think maybe a B. I think we can still tighten up some screws. And I think guys are working toward that. But you got some cases where when you got young high school guys understanding the demand of fight through ball screens, boxing out, chasing guys off screens, that's not an easy thing to do. It really isn't when you get hit with screens and you're going against talented basketball players and with some of the teams we've played thus far. But it's just learning from it. Our big guys coaching, our veteran guys coaching our younger guys, how to fight through screens, how to stay in ball screen. I think we've done the best job since I've been here at Tennessee as far as our ball screen defense. But it's just really taking pride in defending and understanding the importance of when you defend at a high level, you get good results.
After the Virginia game, the guys talked about that team meeting. Do you notice a difference in the camaraderie, the closeness, the chemistry between the players from maybe before then to now?
Tell me about that team meeting. What happened? They had a team meeting and it was none of my business. Was nothing. I said, put it together. Because as teams, that's what you need to do. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with that at all. I always thought they were close off the court. I didn't think our chemistry was as good on the court. And I don't think that was a case of I don't like this guy, I don't get along with this guy. I think it was a case of you have so many new guys. And I think the thing that even I took for granted early in the season as a coach, assuming that we had, 9, 10 guys returning from a team off last year. But you have two new point guards. You have a leading scorer in Jordan McRae, Jarnell Stokes, Josh Richardson was a glue guy, Jerron Maine without 15, 18 months of playing basketball. Then you bring in talented young freshmen. So you got Amani Moore who started, won 9 out of the last 10 games with him starting. Now he's not playing as much now. So I think more than anything, we're just trying to get the chemistry right with the guys, the right lineups. It's not an easy thing to do. You got a guy like Derek Reese, some things you want to see him get better at. And all of a sudden, he's in rotation. So now there's minutes that he'll take from somebody. DeMontre Edwards played well, and he's trying to fight for those minutes. So I think more than anything, just finding the right chemistry of guys to play well together. And you can't, mess with different lineups this time of year and just try to experiment. You have to be ready to go. And I tell the guys all the time, you start determining minutes in August. We can't get into this January and February saying, okay, this guy's earned some minutes. It's just a hard thing to do.
Struggled on the road in general these last few years, but you won like 4 of your last 5 SEC road games, I think, a year ago. What were y'all doing in those games that maybe you haven't done on the road in other situations? But I mean, what's it take now?
Well, I think you look at the first 2 years, we got better on the road as the season went, because that means we got better as a team. And I think, hopefully that's the case. We get off to a better start. But I think in years past, we were just a better team down the stretch. For us, we've played 2 really good road teams, in Xavier and Wichita State, with great environments. So we'll be familiar with a hostile environment. Now it's just a matter of us doing the things we need to do to be successful on both ends of the floor. When teams make runs at home, keep your composure. We've done it, taking a lot of stats and numbers on when we hit rough patches in games, what type of lineups do we have on the floor. Where are we getting our free throws at? Who's getting the ball? Who's not shooting the basketball? So this has probably been the first year that I've spent a lot of hours and times on statistics and numbers and lineups. And I've never been a guy that really focused on outside of the basics, but just the lineups, who we have in a game, who's playing well together. And you just have to, sometimes those numbers are correct.
What combinations work in various situations.
Yes, yes. And that's, for example, you might have certain guys that, you might have lineups where we go 4 minutes where we're not scoring the basketball. Then you have to look back at who's on the floor. Might be certain guys out there. You don't have a leading score out there with those guys. You might have all young guys out there. You might have, might not have a low post score out there. Or you might have 3 or 4 guys out there that don't get to the free throw line. And those are the things when teams make runs, you have to be able to get to the free throw line to get easy baskets, get layups. So those are the things we look at.
So what have you told your guys about opening SEC play?
Yeah, for us, again, I try to keep it one game at a time. It's the most important thing. You're playing against a very talented LSU team, and our guys understand what they bring to the table. We watch film on it. We know who they are. And it's trying to win a road game. Not necessarily, what SEC play is about. It's about winning a basketball game because, again, we play talented teams in the preseason. I just think the focus, changes to league play. I think the one plus, if there's any plus, when you go into league play, you're familiar with your opponent. Even though, guys have new guys, they have some talented young freshmen, they have experienced guys returning, at least you're somewhat familiar with the style and what they present, how they do it. So going into that game, there's not as many unknowns as opposed to the preseason.
When you were talking about spending more time on numbers and stats and combinations, is that all games or just road games in particular?
Oh, well, we do all games. We do road games. We do wins. We do games with numbers and losses. We do it all.
What made you start studying that a little bit more?
Every summer I talk to different coaches. What do they do? What do they look at? And you just try to assess any way to give you an advantage as a team. Now, I've always been a guy to go by what my eyes see. But I just think the numbers help. I don't think they're exact. Because I think at the end of the day, Joel McRae averaged 19 points a game. At the end of the season, he averaged 19 points a game. That's what the numbers say. And I just think that's the same thing with statistics. You have to look at over the course of time. If it's consistent, then that's probably what it is.
Gunther, what impresses you most about LSU?
One of the few teams that they're very similar to us from the standpoint. They got talented perimeter guys. They got big guys that score on the blocks, physical bigs on both sides of the ball, guards that can go in transition, they can make 3-point shots, they can drive the ball. They have a strong bench. They have guys that, you know, started in games last year that are coming off the bench now. So just one of those games, you know, certain teams you can say, okay, these two things we need to do to beat them. These are the two guys we probably need to stop offensively. Well, these guys have five guys on the floor that can make plays. So that means you got to be good at boxing out. Your post defense has to be good. If you help down in the post, they got guys that can make shots from the perimeter. Now you have to be able to close out, stop the three-point shot, but also contain the dribble, which is easier said than done.
You like Johnny O'Brien?
Very good player. Johnny's a very good player. You know, 6'8", 6'9", can score it around the rim, can face up and make shots. Scores it in the post with jump hooks, left and right hand. He shoots it off the glass, turn around jumpers. He face up and make shots. He can drive the ball. He's a big guy that can do a lot of things. And he's strong. You know, that's the thing about him. He's not just a guy that's selling on the print. He's strong around the rim. You have to box him out.
What have you seen out of their freshman, Jordan Mikey?
Oh, talented. You know, watching him out of high school, he was hovering around, I guess, I don't know exact, 35 to, you know, 50, 60 in the country. But he's proven he's one of the best freshmen in all of college basketball, hovering around 14 points a game, 7-8 rebounds, almost 3 blocks a game as a true freshman. Those are really good numbers against the team they've played against, but a talented basketball player.
Do they typically use, do you think their guards are both point guards? I mean, do you view them that way?
I think Stringer's more of a two. Stringer's always been a two, even in high school. I watched him in high school. He's always been a two guard that can really score the ball. And Hickey's a, you know, point guard that scores it as well.
So you talk about playing on the road. What do you think your team took from those games at Xavier and at Wichita that were, you know, kind of close and kind of maybe there for the game?
Both the games. Well, the Xavier game, we got off to a slow start. Fought back in the game. I think we ended up losing by 3 points. We gave ourselves a chance to win the game down the stretch. I think more than anything in that game, playing your first game on the road, because they had two starters that didn't play. Then obviously we played them in the Bahamas, it's a different story. So I think that was more of us mentally than the actual game itself. In Wichita State game, same scenario. Give yourself a chance to win down the stretch. We hit a pass there, we missed some layups, had great opportunities, didn't capitalize, and they made the plays to win the game. But again, going back to the stretch where, you know, having the right guys in, understanding who needs the ball, where they need the ball in order for us to be successful in road games, because it's more mental, and I talk to the guys all the time. It's just a different building, that's all. The rims, the court, everything is still the same. It's just a different building. Our approach doesn't change.
Barton shot the ball really well recently. Do you think he was affected by his injury earlier? Did that throw him off a lot?
I do. I think so. But I also think, you know, the fact that he's running a point guard as a starter consistently, as opposed to playing off the ball more so than being a starter. Now he's running a team, but he's also running a team with experienced guys that have been around the program, and he's trying to find his way. And that's not easy until you get a feel for it. But I do think the leg injury and the finger injury did affect his shot and his mobility to attack the rim and to spot up and make shots and make plays.
Kind of looking at the stats that you were talking about a minute ago, and when the team's getting off to a slow start, sort of analyzing even, you know, whether they were, what they were eating and when they were getting up. Sounds a little like Moneyball in baseball. Is that something that in trying to find these kind of edges, is that something you've always done as a coach, or is it something that just kind of came along later?
The part about the, you know, sleeping and eating, yes, I've always, even as a player, I go back to my days as a player, even when I played in the CBA Continental Basketball League, and even in Europe, what I was eating before games, I just did everything I did in college. You know, 4 hours, 3.5, 4 hours before a game, the way you're sleeping. Working out in the morning, whatever it was I did as a basketball player and I learned in college, I just took that with me professionally. I thought it helped me physically. I used to lift weights before games. I didn't do it in college, but professionally I lift weights before games, and I thought it helped my body and to be ready to play. But I think it helps. But you also got to get a feel for your players, the body language, fresh legs. Cause the most important thing is fresh legs. I've always been a guy that practiced 3 hours a day. But I think you have to change in some ways. Now, we probably go 2 hours max, and that's including stretching. And as we get into February, you're talking about maybe hour 15, because I think fresh legs are very important. But you got to practice at a high level when you're on the floor, whatever it is you're doing.
Both these teams have quality bigs. How important is the rebounding battle going to be in this game, maybe even more so than a typical game?
Well, I think it's very important. You're talking about two of the better rebounding teams in college basketball. And then with Johnny, and Jordan, two of the better offensive rebounders probably in college basketball. But I think the same thing that they're going through is with us. Our guards and our wing guys have to rebound. I think, I mean, in the case, they might sit there and their guards are watching those big guys rebound. It's the same for us. Our guards have to get in there and get big rebounds. Because when you box on a guy just as talented as you are on the glass like this, sometimes he might get a swim move and get an advantage. But if your guards in there getting their nose dirty, you got a chance to get those rebounds.
Coach Gary's not assisted today. Seems like he's not having a lot of the freshman growing pains that you might expect a kid this time. What's making it easier for him than it might be?
I like to think of course, his high school coach coached college basketball, so he understood it. His dad has coached college ball for years. And his dad has also let him know these are a lot of things you have to work on. If you want to play and be a part of that team, you have to work and get better. So he's heard it from the standpoint of you're not the best player in high school basketball. You know, it's not always a pat on the back. It's a case of you got to work to get better every day. But you're also talking about a young man that spent hours in the gym working on his craft, working on his shot. He's maintained his weight. He's at 183 pounds. He's really maintained his weight from the time he got here. But a guy, I think, that wants to be a great player, not just talk about it. I think he wants to be the best.
Kenzo, your point guard shooting less than 50% at the foul line. Does that concern you about him being in a close game late?
Yes, it does. Got to be able to make those shots down a stretch of games. But he's spending, you know, the good thing about it, he's spending time in the gym working on it. But you got to be able to make shots down the stretch because, again, the opposing teams see these same numbers. And if the game gets close in situations like that, I'm quite sure they'll try to foul and force him to make free throws.
Do you see anything in his technique that's a concern?
Not at all, because his form is good, just like his three-point shot. His technique is good. I talked to him about where he's putting his foot at on the free throw line. More than anything, because it changes. You're talking about maybe, you know, inch or two. That's a big difference when you're shooting free throws, just the focus. But his repetition or his approach to the free throw shot is still the same. But I just think his feet need to be consistent.